I'd like to welcome everybody to Grand Haven's Candidates Night. I want to thank all the candidates for giving of their valuable time to show up with us this evening. And I'd like to start tonight with a Pledge of Allegiance. So if you could all please rise. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Again, I'd like to welcome all the candidates who've given of their valuable time to show up this evening. I also want to welcome our mayor, John Noak, who isn't going to be talking to you tonight because he's got 2 years off before he has to do this again. A few of the rules. There is to be no videotaping of anyone speaking tonight. Questions are only to be allowed from Grand Haven residents. Candidates are taken in the order in which they appear on the ballot. Each candidate will be given 3 minutes to make a statement, followed by questions. There is a table in the back for any election material the candidates would like to leave. I want to remind everyone of our cake poll in the back of the room, like the straw polls. There's a Democratic cake and a Republican cake. And I'd like to now call, oh, and by the way, there are two microphones. This one is for the candidate to hold in their hand, and the other is for Romeoville Television, which is televising tonight's event. And I want to thank Kevin McHale for his hard work on that. Our first speaker tonight is going to be Scott Poynton from the White Oak Library System. Scott?
Thank you, Dan. Thank you all for having me tonight. So I want to start off by telling a very quick little story. Our library organization was started by the Lockport Women's Club in 1921. In 1929, they had put a question on the ballot so the voters could approve the library being taken over by the township government. In that, we recently, earlier this year, found a handbill from that election that showed, and that was successful, by the way, and it showed that the library tax in 1929 was 18 cents per $100 of assessed value. Our tax rate today is 18.54 cents per $100 of assessed value. So nearly 100 years later, and we're a little bit more than a half of a penny higher rate than we were then. So why I'm in front of you today is we have a question on the ballot, November 6th. The increase that we're asking will hit the average homeowner for about $1.40 a month, which equates to about $16.80 per year. The reason why that we're asking for this money is we want to increase our hours. And you know, there's a lot of stories. You know, people say libraries are over, everything's digital, everything's on the internet. This past fiscal year, the one that we just wrapped up, June 30th, was our second busiest year in our history. We've been around almost 100 years. It was our second busiest year ever. Nearly 700,000 items were checked out from our libraries. The attendance at our programs is up 125% since 2010. So we want to increase our hours. The second thing we would like to do is increase our outreach services. Many of you residents of Grand Haven are probably aware of and maybe take advantage of our outreach service, Tina and Jenny and the ladies that come here. We need to do more of that. 25% of our residents in our district are senior citizens. That's 20,000 residents. So we want to expand that department. And lastly, we want to create a digital media lab where people of all ages, but especially school-age children, can learn the technological skills at the library that they need for the future. So this is why we're asking for that increase. It is on the ballot for November 6th. If anybody has any questions about the library or about this question, I'd be happy to answer them. Yes, ma'am.
I just want to say that a half of our tax bill is for the schools. And we don't have any children in our schools. But on my tax bill, it says that I pay $141 for for library. And my receipt from the library says that this year I saved $3,244. So I just want people to know that this is the biggest bargain, so vote yes.
Thank you so much. The average return on investment, if you added up all the dollars that come to us from our taxpayers, and then you add up the value of all the materials and services that go out the door, it's 5.5 to 1. $5.50 worth of benefit for every $1 that comes in. Any other questions? I feel like I'm staring straight into the sun. Yes, sir.
On the Weber Road.
The Crest Hill Library?
Right.
Yeah.
Why isn't there a bigger sign up?
So a lot of people have asked that.
I mean, I didn't know it was a library because somebody told me.
Sure. That's kind of a byproduct of being the first one in a development right before a recession kind of crushes all the development. So we don't own the land along Weber Road. Our library is set far back. So we couldn't build a sign along Weber Road if we wanted to. But the idea is when that 40-acre development all gets fleshed out, there will be some sort of large monument sign out at Weber Road, and all the businesses in the development will get a chance to, you know, buy their little corner of it and put their signs on there. But we as the library district, it wouldn't be a good use of tax dollars for us to construct that sign and then in the hopes that development will happen and we can get our money back from future businesses. It doesn't really solve the problem. I agree with you. We need more identity there, but that's why it is the way it is. Any other thoughts or questions? Yes, ma'am.
I have a question, and you probably alluded to this already, but being a former teacher, I saw that there were a lot of high school students and college students using the library. Because a lot of times the kids said, at home I can't concentrate, you know, the kids are running, the younger brothers are running around, and they always ask for longer hours. Is that something that you want to do if you get more money?
It is, absolutely. We want to open earlier in the mornings, which will help lots of people, but really help moms with young kids that aren't in school yet. And we hear all the time, you know, the mom puts the older kids on the school bus, and then they wish they could take the younger kid right to the library at that moment, and we're not open. We don't open until 10. So earlier in the morning, later at night, and I'm most excited about Fridays. Right now we close at 5 p.m. on Fridays. If this were successful, we would stay open until 7 p.m. Really, we could do a lot of good on Friday evenings, and then more hours on the weekends as well. So the hours are really the it's all important, it's all wonderful, but the hours are really something that we need. Okay, thank you.
I want to remind everyone that the Grand Haven Civic Club is a nonpartisan organization, and we put on these programs to educate our residents and the voters in the community as to the issues. Since no one from the statewide ballot has RSVP'd to us today, we're going to start with our representative in the General Assembly, and our first speaker is Alyssa Bedford. Alyssa?
Good evening, everyone, and thank you for having us out tonight. My name is Alicia Benford. I am a 19-year Bolingbrook resident. I grew up on the west side of Chicago and actually moved to Bolingbrook because I wanted to find affordable housing to raise my children, and then also, obviously, quality school district. So 19 years later, I'm still here. I remain as active as I can in my community. I'm a member of our local Rotary Club. I served as a chamber president and a member of the Bolingbrook Chamber Board for a while. I also was appointed to our Bolingbrook Police Pension Board by our mayor. And then there was an opening on our township board, so I moved over to the township board about 7 years ago. And now here I am as your candidate for state representative in this area. So I've been busy in the community as much as I can. After I graduated from Lane Tech High School, I decided to go to college in Florida. One reason, obviously, is because it's warm weather, but enjoyed my time there. Came back here and at some point started my own business. I worked for Deloitte & Touche and Motorola, and my very first day at my first job at Deloitte & Touche, I met a young lady by the name of Kimmy Brown Ellen, who became my business partner. So we have been business partners for over 20 years. She manages our Southside office and on Chicago, and I actually take care of the office out here in Bolingbrook. A couple years ago, I decided I wanted to go back to school and get another degree, and so I went back to school and I decided to get a master's in governmental accounting because it's a unique thing, and obviously in the state of Illinois, I know that that's something that we need here. So I am a book person, love numbers, and I'm now finishing up a doctorate where I'm looking at pension plans, property taxes, and their impact on education funding. And I know one young lady stood up and said something about our property tax bill. Close to 60% of your property tax bill goes to the school district. So when you don't have children in that district, what are some of the things that we can do to make sure that we're lowering the taxes for your area? So that is one of the other areas that I'm studying as well. Again, I've been around for a while. I'm very active in the community. This has been a great experience, and I'm enjoying this opportunity to run for state representative. When this district was formed back in 2012, I was actually asked to run for state representative at that time by the gentleman, his name was Senator Wilhelmy. We had developed a relationship when I was a member of the chamber. And so I'm a unique candidate because I've actually been asked by both sides at some point to run. And this time I am running on the Republican ticket as a state representative, and for a number of reasons. One is because in our business community, of course, we want to also make sure that we're paying the least amount of taxes as well. So, again, great experience, and I look forward to answering any questions you have. I had to give you my life history in 3 minutes, so I know I spoke pretty fast, but if you guys have any questions for me, please let me know. I feel like I'm yelling into the mic.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello. Welcome to Grand Haven.
Thank you.
I'd like to know how you feel about a progressive income tax in the state of Illinois. State of Illinois, as I understand it, is one of the three lowest in the country. That has a flat tax system. Mm-hmm. So I'd like to know how you feel about that and what you would do.
That's a good question. I can tell you that when the last budget was passed, there was a tax increase that impacted individuals as well as businesses. I personally do not agree with a progressive income tax. My clients, I'm a CPA, so you know, completing tax returns, their biggest concern is that they feel like they're paying more in taxes and they're not receiving more in services. So I am not a proponent of the progressive income tax.
Any other questions for Alyssa?
Yes, I'd like to know what plans you would have for lowering the high cost of medical care and prescription drugs. This is an issue that's of utmost importance to senior citizens.
It is, and one of the parts of my story that I skipped over is I'm also a recent breast cancer survivor, so I know the high cost of medical insurance, how that actually impacted my family. And if I did not have affordable health care as a person that was self-employed, it would have been difficult for me to remain in business and difficult for me to raise my family. So I do agree that we need to lower our health care costs, especially our prescription costs for people that need monthly prescriptions as well. In my opinion, the way that you do that is that you have to work with the pharmaceutical companies as well as with your state legislature to make sure that we control those costs for the seniors and for individuals with pre-existing conditions as well.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
I'm wondering.
I feel like this light is right in my face. No, I felt like the light is right in my face, so I can really.
Your thoughts on what you might do to support educational funding.
That's a good question. Educational funding, again, I was explaining that I'm kind of a numbers nerd. So one of the things that when I decided to go back and get my doctorate, I wanted to look at education funding. So I'm working on a program through Florida State University because I know, again, that one, the state is supposed to be the primary funder of education. That is what it says in our state constitution. And right now, that does not appear to be the case because that cost is being passed on to homeowners in the area. area. So I am looking at that by studying the pension plans and the property taxes, which is the biggest impact on our education funding. And I'm looking at that for the three largest school districts in the country, so Chicago, New York, and LA. So I plan to help tackle that problem by studying it throughout the state and figuring out what other states are doing to make sure that they keep their property taxes low for individuals and being able to carry that over here to the state of Illinois. Any other questions for me? All right.
Thanks, Alyssa.
Thank you.
Hi, our next speaker is our current state representative, no stranger to Grand Haven, Natalie Manley.
Good evening. Hello, everybody. How's that sound? Joe's coaching me while I'm sitting there. My name is Natalie Manley. I am your state representative. Can you hear me okay? Okay. I've been representing the residents here and all through the 98th District for the past 6 years. During this time, relationships and my relationship-based style of leadership is what I've tried to do here in the district. Since day one, I've gone directly to the people I represent and created many opportunities for participation. First, I host monthly legislative advisory committees. I have a retirees legislative advisory committee, I have a veterans legislative advisory committee, and I have two women's legislative advisory committees. Many people here at Grand Haven participate in those committees, and they know how important the work is that we do. Many ideas are shared during these meetings, and a lot of questions have been raised. A lot of solutions have come through those meetings, and I really use that as a basis for my legislative agenda. Second, I've created satellite office hours. In this very room, once a month, I come in on the first Friday of every month from 2 to 4 and conduct what I like to call a penalty-free zone discussion. I encourage everyone to come. I'm a Democrat. That doesn't mean only Democrats can be there. I invite everyone to join us, and everyone is allowed to speak their mind and say what they think without fear. And we don't always agree. There's very lively exchanges. I think that's putting it mildly, but they're extremely important to me as the person that you have representing you in Springfield. Third, I host meetings and coffees throughout the district, oftentimes twice a month, sometimes more, at different locations at different times to try to get people to come in and participate and talk to me. I have town halls, I participate in other community conversations, and my office meets with people, and sometimes I go to people's homes if the need is there. Lastly, I host a variety of informal seminars and forums, and we like to call in experts, like the AG's office will come in and talk about identity theft. I have shred days to help you to make sure you're guarded against that, and also if somebody gets your information, your credit could be affected. We have health fairs, property tax assessment updates, public safety forums every year. And once a year, I host what I call a night to honor women. I bring in expert speakers to address certain topical issues. And also, I pick a community leader to honor her as a woman of distinction. Throughout my time as your state representative, I've been standing up for and with my constituents, supporting legislation that is beneficial to the district and opposing legislation that may harm our residents. I've been recognized for my bipartisanship and my willingness to work with those who are there to solve problems for the people of Illinois. I've supported freezing property taxes. Last time I counted, I voted for that 19 times. Speaking to the problem with property taxes, I voted for Senate Bill 1947, which was the evidence-based model that is truly the first step toward property tax reform. We put $350 million into K-12 education. We already discussed how big that part is on your property tax bill. And I will continue to support funding for schools to really bring true property tax reform. Any other ideas are local. The state does not get one penny from your property tax bill. It's all local. I'm sure you guys know that. I've been outspoken in caucus and in committee and on the House floor against taxing retirement income. It's not an option for me. Regarding public safety, I've supported many common sense gun reforms that the General Assembly has undertaken and continue to push my colleagues to recognize that mental health and the funding of vital programs are critical to addressing the violence we've all seen around us, whether it's in the form of gun violence, domestic violence, or substance abuse. I serve on a total of 8 House committees, including the largest committee, which is the Mental Health Committee. But I also serve on Human Services Appropriations, where we create the budget for vital programs and services that are needed right here in Will County. Meals on Wheels, early childhood development, funding for domestic violence shelters, and funding for breast and cervical cancer screenings and treatment. I'm the chairwoman of the Cost-Benefit Analysis Committee. I created this committee, and this committee looks at programs and their spending through testimony and fact-based evidence, determining if the program results are worth the money we spend on it. That's really an important way to look at our state spending, and it's something that I, as a CPA, understand fully. There are many pieces of legislation, I'm getting to the end. There are many pieces of legislation that I've been proud to support and or sponsor. First one, Joliet Hospice Home Expansion. Second one, the Silver Search Program, where I work closely with law enforcement to provide protections for those who go missing that are suffering with Alzheimer's or other forms of dementia. I helped pass the ERA. I sponsored the telepsychiatry bill, which allows access to mental health professionals via the computer for those who live in underserved areas. I sponsored and passed the Veterans Home Protection Bill that came in response to the horrific conditions at Quincy and the many veterans died from Legionnaires' disease. The list goes on and on. I will spare you the rest of the list. Finally, I want you to know, and I mean this from the bottom of my heart, being your state representative has been an honor. And I want to thank you all for your friendship and your warmth, your lively conversation once a month, and the things that you do to be involved in the community. And I look forward to continuing to be your voice in Springfield. Thank you.
Questions?
Any questions? And if you're over here, I can't see you, so you have to shout.
No questions for Natalie?
Thank you
very much,
thank
Natalie. Our next speaker is the, since we have no incumbent county clerk, is Lori McPhillips, the Republican candidate for Will County Clerk. Lori?
Good evening, and thank you all for coming out tonight. I'm Lori McPhillips, and I'm running for Will County Clerk. And that is quite a spotlight on you here. A little background about me. I've been married for 25 years. We just celebrated our 25th wedding anniversary a couple weeks ago, my husband and I. We have a son who's 18 years old. He just earned his Eagle Scout rank a few months ago, so we're very proud of him. And then he went off to college, so we're empty nesters right now. And my husband and I have been selling real estate for the past 25 or so years and rehabbing houses. So we actually work together, live together, and then rehabbing houses together. So it's quite a feat to get to that 25 years and doing all those projects. And I'd like to say that I can operate pretty much any power tool. I can do drywall, I can take a toilet out, and I could put a toilet back in as well. And also, I can do tile, pretty much anything that needs to be done, so I'm well-versed, and I'm ready to take on any challenge. Going back to high school, I was on the math team, so I am, like Alicia, I'm a nerd with numbers, and I love numbers, and I was also on student government for about 4 years. And that kind of led me, after I graduated from high school, to work at the county. So I started, like our current county clerk, Nancy Schultz-Voots, right out of high school, I started working at the county, went to night school, got my associate's degree. I waitressed, worked full-time, got my bachelor's degree then, and concentrating in business administration in 5 years. working two jobs. And I worked my way up through the county, which is great to learn everything as you go along. So I started out as a secretary and worked my way up to county board administrator. I was the only staff person for 27 county board members back then. So I learned to serve both Democrats and Republicans, which is what this is. This is a bipartisan office. You serve everybody when you're county clerk. And then I also got appointed to director of operations, promoted basically to director of operations to the county executive. And in this role, I supervised almost 1,000 employees, 15 county departments. I had the IT department, the payroll department. I was responsible for preparing and implementing the county's, at that time, $250 million budget. And also Sunny Hill Nursing Home was under our purview, as well as the highway department and several other departments as well. So it was a wonderful opportunity for me. And then I left that job and got elected to recorder of deeds. And in that office, I implemented the first ever land records management system that was on the internet. So we digitized records, and that was a campaign promise that I ended up completing within 6 months. We were testing a system. So we're very proud of that system. And it's just a convenience for taxpayers to be able to go online. And we shared that with other taxing bodies as well. Because at that time, in 2004 to 2008, there was a lot of buying and selling and foreclosures towards the end of that time. So all the municipalities could actually have access to that information 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. And the police departments could get that information too, so they knew who owned a piece of property. And then we shared that information with the Veterans Assistance Commission. We used to have veterans which were not able to really come down to our office and weren't as mobile, that we gave the Veterans Assistance Commission, we deputized one of their people in that office so they can get their DD-214s right at that office. So we're trying to be innovative. I opened a satellite office in the DuPage Township office at no cost. We transferred an employee up to that office. And in the county clerk's office, it's a management office. It's a $4.8 million budget approximately, and 27 staff in that office too. And also you're managing a lot of part-time staff and temporary election judges. So it's a lot going on in that office. It's a tax extension office where all the taxing bodies file their levies as well. And I worked with that office when I was developing the budget. I've been a voter registrar as well. And I worked with three county clerks, which is why the current county clerk, Nancy Schultz-Foots, the former county clerk, Jan Gould, both endorsed me for this office. They both worked in that office. They both worked for the county. They know what it takes to run that office, and it is a management office that experience is really important in that office. And I was also endorsed by the Will County Sheriff's Deputies Union, and I've been involved in our community as well. And when I take on a committee that I'm on or a volunteer opportunity, I try to put in it as much as I can and get out of it as well. And I was recognized as the Athena Award winner through the Joliet Chamber and Working Women's Council. I was Exchange Light of the Year. I currently am the treasurer too for the Exchange Club, and I was also president for Exchange Club. And I was the Spanish Center recognized me as well because I did a food drive to help out when their food pantry was getting low. And I've also received the Gleaner Award for public service as well. And most importantly, when I was Recorder of Deeds, I received the Fiscal Responsibility Award for turning back the most taxpayers' dollars. So I would ask for your support November 6th. This is a big office, and there's big shoes to fill with Nancy Schultz-Voot. She did a wonderful job in that office, and I'm going to wish her the best in retirement. But thank you for your time. Are there any questions? Yes.
Hi. Again, welcome. Hi.
Thank you very much.
As you know, voting is on the minds of quite a few people right now.
Exactly.
And I'd like to know what your thoughts are about how to improve the integrity of the voting system and how to make our voting system easier and more accessible to everyone.
Sure. The voting system is regulated by laws, of course, that are passed by the state of Illinois. And I think we have some pretty good laws right now on the books, and one of the most convenient ways to vote is vote by mail. So you can go online, call the county clerk's office, you can request a ballot be mailed to your home, which is very convenient, because a lot of times you'll go to the voting, to the polls, and there might be a person on there that you don't know, and it's always good to research your candidates. And with so many offices up at certain times a year, it's nice to be able to get that ballot mailed to your home and vote from your kitchen table. You can discuss it as a family. If you have children in the family, it's kind of nice to share that experience with them as well. And as far as the integrity of the voting system, Nancy Shields Foods, I was actually involved on the budget side when she purchased the current system. And two key things with that current system, it has not had any issues, and so we're very blessed there. But it's one system, so you don't have two systems talking to each other, which is key, and there's paper ballots. And I've gone to a seminar at University of Chicago they had with a lot of other taxing, with the David Orr, the Cook County clerk, as well as some other, and there were actually hackers there that had tested a lot of systems, and that was the one thing they recommended for any system is a paper ballot. And the county clerk has a set of checks and balances in place right now where they do a pretest, which they're going to be doing that on October 24th. It's open to the public at 9 a.m. And then after the election, the State Board of Elections takes 5% of random precincts and asks the clerk to run those through the systems again to make sure you get accurate results and it matches that of the election night. So there's a lot of good systems and checks and balances that are in place right now. And we still need to keep looking at our system. It's 16 years old, and that's one of the things I would do to see if there's any updated technology that we could take advantage of as well, and just keep making sure that our system is always monitored, because people are always trying to hack it regardless. So you got to keep your eyes open, and those checks and balances really pay off. Any other questions? Thank you for your time.
Our next speaker is the Democratic candidate for county clerk, Lauren Staley-Ferry. Lauren?
Hello, everyone. Thanks for having me here tonight. I appreciate the time. My name is Lauren Staley-Ferry, and I am the Democratic candidate for Will County Clerk. I was born and raised right here in Will County and have lived in Joliet for most of my life. My husband, Ed, is a union electrician, and we are the proud parents of our 8-year-old son, Matthew. For the past 11 years, I worked as a process improvement expert for a top 10 financial institution. In 2014, I ran for County Board in District 9 as a political newcomer. No political agenda or well-connected family. I won my election and also became the first Latina board member in Will County's history. Achieving that accomplishment while working full-time, completing my college degree, and chasing a toddler around was a challenge. But for nearly two decades, I have remained committed to serving my community, and it has been my honor to serve the residents of District 9. I am running for this office because I am uniquely qualified to raise the bar as county clerk. I've spent over a decade managing data protection and cybersecurity initiatives for literally hundreds of thousands of consumers for a Fortune 500 financial institution. As a current member of the Will County Board, I have a unique understanding of our county's current successes, challenges, and opportunities. During my time in office, we've expanded vital services, reduced the county's debt, and lowered the tax rate every year. Throughout my term on the county board and 2 years in a leadership position, my colleagues have commended me for taking the time to learn how every department works, for reaching across the aisle, and ultimately putting the residents first. My vision for the clerk's office is simple. Security, access, and efficiency are my top priorities. I cannot say this enough. The security of our elections cannot and will not be taken lightly. I will assemble a security review team that consists of cybersecurity professionals, the Will County State's Attorney, and other qualified elected officials who will review any and all current and potential systems that we put into place. Additionally, the services offered by the clerk's office must be accessible to all residents. As your next county clerk, I will be visible, inclusive, and proactive with residents in regards to outreach. My office will expand early voting hours and increase the number of polling places to ensure access for all voters. It is my firm belief that every citizen should have convenient access to exercise our most important right. Finally, my staff and I will work together to enhance efficiency across the board. During my tenure in the private sector, I was regarded as an expert in process improvement. So from document turnaround time to the training of election judges, there's always room for growth. My name is Lauren Staley-Ferry, and I'm asking for your support as your next Will County Clerk. Thank you. Yeah, sorry. Does anybody have any questions for me? Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Our next speaker is the current Will County Treasurer, Steve Weber.
Hello, everybody. Thanks for having us here, and thanks for being informed voters. I grew up in Mokena. I'm married. I've got three kids that are almost bigger than I am. And I went to school right down the street in Romeoville College, Lewis University, where I studied accounting and finance. I was honored to be your auditor, your watchdog, a couple years back. During my time as your auditor, I found a lot of fraud in Will County, a lot of waste and abuse. And I was nationally recognized in that office for innovative accounting. And one of my fraud cases got published worldwide to train other anti-fraud professionals how to uncover computer fraud. So during that time in the auditor's office, I really thought that's what God intended me to do. But when I lost that office, we lost all the Republican elected officials countywide that year. I started my own practice because I'm a CPA. So 2 years later, the party came to me and said, we need you to run for Will County Treasurer. And I said, I'm an auditor. During that time, you know, I talked to my wife about it and I said, you know what? That's a financial office. And having the books and the records, I think, is unique. I'm the only treasurer in Will County that was the auditor prior, and I think I really recommend it. Not that anybody would run for that first, but it gives me the insight into that office. So when I came into the treasurer's office, I knew the accounting system because they used to close with me every month when I was in the auditor's office. So I knew the staff. I knew the security in that office. Since I've been your treasurer, what have I done for you? Because this is really a report card. Well, unlike a lot of elected officials, I reduce the fees. I don't raise them. For seniors, the duplicate tax bill is zero. You pay nothing. If you're doing an ACH or an e-check out of your checking account, that's free. We just went out to bid again for the credit card, so I've reduced the credit card cost 20%. So if you do pay by credit card, they're lower. Next year, we just put in place, I started the prepayment program with Will County prior to me. You had to pay in June or September. You didn't have an option. When I came in, you could pay what you want, when you want. But next year, you can structure it. So after January, you'll be able to set it up on the website, and you can have it pay every month out of your account. You can also select to pay out of your credit card 1 month, out of your Discover 1 month, maybe get the points up on that, and then go to your Visa. My wife says you got to use my Discover card for Amazon because she's getting 5 times points this month. You got to do what you got to do. So options, flexibility. This, and when I say that I'm a CPA and I think that's important, it's important because I invest $400 million. This week, every month we go out to bid with the market and ladder our investments. So as they mature, we renew them. we go out and get new rates. This week we invested $55 million, and we that day we publish it so it's transparent. We put out who won, first, second, third. We had about six banks participating, and the top three got the best rates. So I'm very proud of that transparency, so anybody can look it up and see what we did. It's all above bar. What has that meant to you? And I think this is important. I look back, and when I went to the county board for my budget, and they chopped me every year, even though the first year I was in, I returned $240,000 that I didn't need unspent and cut overtime to zero, because that's what I was really good at as the watchdog, cutting costs. A normal treasurer, and I looked at Republican and Democrats to be fair, I make about double what they do in the interest. In reality, the last 2 years have been, because of Trump, the only good really interest years. So I was dealing with some bad banking. I also have 10 years experience in the banking industry, so that helps me negotiate with these banks to get the best rate. But what does that mean to you? So over, since I've been elected, I've made over $50 million in interest to the county. And that benefits everybody. That goes to the whole county. They use it for the budget. In addition to that, when I do the levy, when I take in taxes from you folks, I have to pay that out to the different taxing districts, the school districts, the parks. I invest that. Because I hired a full-time investment manager in that office and still came in under budget. And we invest that. This year, the schools got about $600,000 more than they anticipated. And why do we do that? We do that, hopefully, so they don't raise their levies. Because if I can make that money in 30 days and give it to them, hopefully it keeps your taxes low. And that's why I do what I do. We enjoy making a difference. So, does anybody have any questions? Come on. We got one over there. Yes, ma'am.
You mentioned the amount of interest that you made. Is that the gross, or was there an expense to that interest that would bring that down to a net effect?
That is the gross. Now, most of the accounts have what they call compensating balances, so the county doesn't really pay fees. BMO Harris Bank, when I first came in, was lying about their fees, and I closed their $30 million account because if I can't trust that bank, they need to go, and it made Chicago Crane's business. This credit card that I spoke of that we just bid out, because of that bid, we freed up about $10 million in compensating balances that the prior vendor made us keep to avoid the fees. So now I can invest that $10 million and make more interest for the county. So that's what's healthy about being aggressive with these banks, knowing how they operate. And the ones who do charge us straight fees, we look at those every year. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Our next speaker is the Democratic candidate for County Treasurer, Tim Brophy. Tim?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and thanks for being here tonight. Pleasure to meet you all. My name is Tim Brophy. I'm running for Will County Treasurer on the Democratic ticket. I'll tell you a little bit about myself. I was born and raised here in Joliet. I've lived here all my life except for a few years when I went away to school. Mom was a nurse at St. Joe's. Dad was a Joliet firefighter. And I have four siblings. I have three kids, two in college and one in high school. And a very proud dad. We valued public service in my family. I learned it early. I ran for class vice president in high school. And then when I went away to college, I got on the student senate in freshman year and continued that service throughout my time at Illinois Wesleyan University. When I came home from college, I ran for the Joliet City Council in 1985. I didn't win. I ran again in 1995, and I did win, and I served on the Joliet City Council for 16 years. So I want to tell you things that you need to know about somebody that could take the place of an incumbent treasurer, and that's somebody that is prepared and experienced and trusted. We don't have any term limits in these offices, and so it's right that your incumbents are tested. There was no one in the primary that ran for treasurer, so the party reached out to me, and I was nominated by the party and was put on the November ballot so that you had a choice. And that choice is important. So about preparation, as I said, I did a BA at Illinois Wesleyan University in Bloomington, Illinois, and then went to work in banking. I was in banking about 27 years. I then, after 4 years at work, I went back to school to the University of Chicago Graduate School of Business, it's now called Booth, for my MBA in finance. Experience part of the job, from banking, taking care of constituents, and real estate, taking care of clients, and now in association management, taking care of members. I work currently in association management. As far as being trusted, I've served in positions that my fellow community members have put me in. For example, I served on the Joliet Area Historical Museum for about 12 years on that board. I'm past president of the Joliet Rotary Club. I currently serve as president of the Will County Habitat for Humanity, and I serve on the Joliet Arsenal Development Authority as well. I'm also president of the Irish American Society of County Will. You might have some members here in the room. I've been endorsed by the Operators Local 150, the Sheriff's Deputies, the Will County Sheriff's Deputies, and the Stagehands down at the Rialto, IATSE Local 124. So, but I think your incumbents need to be tested, and especially in this case, I'm running because this incumbent treats this as a part-time job. Now, this is full-time compensation that you, the taxpayers, pay the Will County Treasurer. And I don't think that's appropriate that it be treated as a part-time job. This is a management position. With a degree in finance, I can certainly handle the investments that are required of this office. But when you're managing people, you need to be present. When you're cooperating with other county offices, you need to be present. And you have to be careful not to do things unilaterally that you would do in your own business. For example, the special schedule that the employees enjoy in the treasurer's office is a dangerous precedent to set because of the relationships with other employees in other offices who may want to do the same thing. And it may put us in a legal bind at some point when an employee sues the county that says, well, they can work this schedule in that office, why can't I work it in this office? This treasurer needs to be tested because he has hired his wife to work in the office without the scrutiny and the usual process of posting the job and taking applications from other people. I don't care how you explain nepotism, it's nepotism. And I think he should be challenged for that, and I think you, the taxpayer, should question that. And this current treasurer takes money from some of those banks into which the taxpayers' dollars are deposited. I don't think that's right. I think you should be completely independent and bias-free, conflict-free as a treasurer. And lastly, the job of investment manager. You know, many heads are better than one. All your eggs in one basket is not a good idea from an investment point of view. And I think if I were treasurer, I would institute a citizens committee of investment advisors who can objectively decide into which depositories that your tax funds are deposited and not rely on simply one employee that serves the office. So for these reasons and for the joy of serving constituents like you, I respectfully ask for your vote on November 6th. Thank you. Questions? Any questions?
No questions.
Thank you.
Thanks, Tim.
Thanks, Ken.
Our next speaker is our current sheriff, Mike Kelly. Mike?
used to work in investigations, and that looks like an interrogation light. So I don't know. Nobody, I don't want to be interrogated up here. Thanks for having us out tonight. Really appreciate the time. My name is Mike Kelly. I'm a lifelong resident of Will County. I'm a widower. I lost my wife to breast cancer in January of this year. And she was sick for 8.5 years, fought it like way harder than I would have. Taught me a lot of valuable lessons with that. We are the proud parents of three young men now. They're men. I'm a 30-year consecutive year employee of the Will County Sheriff's Office. I got hired in 1988 when I was 21 years old, and I'm now 51. I spent my entire adult life serving and protecting the citizens of Will County. 4 years ago, I was approached by an overwhelmingly majority of the department asking me to run for this office. With the support of the department, I said yeah, and I did it, and I got lucky and won 4 years ago. In the last 4 years, we've accomplished.
Well, this other microphone.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Pick you up in your
water.
All right.
Okay.
Thanks.
I'm used to bossing people around, Ken. So, in the last 4 years, this administration, my administration, has accomplished several things. We made a lot of campaign promises 4 years, one of which was. We were one of the few counties left in the state of Illinois that was not handling foreclosures in-house. I promised 4 years ago that if I got elected, that would be something that we would do. And we did. About 3 years ago now, the sheriff's office is the auctioneer for foreclosures. And because of that, in the last 3 years, we brought in about $600,000 that we would have been paying a private law firm. Had we not, because that's what we were doing prior, we were paying a private law firm to be our auctioneer. So we went around the surrounding counties and stole a little bit from each one, established our own foreclosure system, and now the taxpayers are benefiting that because we are collecting, like I said, we collected about $600,000 in the first 3 years that's been in place. Another thing we did is we developed an administrative toll ordinance that we presented to county board and said, hey, look, if your vehicle is used in the commission of a crime and or you are arrested for a major traffic offense, we tow your vehicle. We tow it and we slap a $350 tow fee on that. You have to pay that before you can even get that vehicle out of the tow yard, before you even pay the tow company. We did that because we wanted the people that use our system, obviously more than others, should have to pay a little more than what. I mean, I'm 51 years old and I've never had to use that system, and I'm sure some of you never have either. So why do you have to supplement someone who uses that constantly? That was about 3 years ago. Another program that's brought in about $600,000. We've taken that money and we were able to equipped our every single squad car at the Will County Sheriff's Office has an in-car camera in it. That money is what those cameras is what that money was paid for. So we also, another thing I wanted to do 4 years ago, as you guys probably see in the news, is there's a lot of school violence out there. Every time you turn on the TV, you see somebody getting injured and or a shooter in a school. So this administration took a proactive approach on that, and we now have trained every single one of our deputies, retrained them on an active school shooter. If it's, if there's someone in a school and they're actively shooting and killing people, we are all trained now, retrained and trained again. We've taken that show on the road too. What we've gone is we've gone into schools and we've trained their faculty. We train their students to say, hey, this is what you need to do if this happens in Will County. God forbid it ever does. You know, I never thought I'd see a day when one of our guys was shot in the line of duty, and that just happened 2 days ago as well. So you can't say you don't, and I pray I don't ever have to see that, but we have to prepare for it, and we did that. There's a lot more. The canine, the prior administration had gotten rid of the whole canine division. We had no canines. We brought that back. We have five dogs now, and our dogs are scent dogs. They're not attack dogs. So all they do is track drugs and or scent. Our dogs we've had some Alzheimer patients who wandered away from home. Our dogs have found them because they're not attack dogs. They're just scent dogs. The attack dogs are too much of a liability nowadays, and people are getting away from them. That's why we didn't want to have them. So now we have a very successful canine division, one of the best in the state. We started an interdiction team where we're hitting I-55 and I-80, and we just hit that 355 and 55. We made a stop on a car and had 21 kilos of heroin, $2.1 million street value because of our interdiction team. So I believe my record has spoke for itself the last 4 years. I couldn't do it without my team. One of my chiefs is here today. These guys, you know, I couldn't do it without them. I'm not a one-man show, obviously. This is a team effort. And that's why I have the endorsement of the whole Sheriff's Department, along with Joliet Police, along with Joliet Fire, along with Will Grundy Building Trades, Will County Central Trades, because they've seen what I've done in the last 4 years. And I know there's more work to be done, and I respectfully stand here before you and ask you to reelect me on November 6th. Thank you. Any questions? Come on, the police always get questions.
Question for Sheriff Kelly?
Thank you again, Rick. Yeah, go ahead.
I have a question. What do you think about school violence? You touched on this, but do you believe that a teacher should be trained or armed? What do you think is a very viable, and how about gun control?
Yeah, I do not believe that our teachers need to be armed. They're there to teach our kids. They have enough burden on them to be teachers. They do not need to be armed. We just teamed with the Homer schools. It's a pilot program that we just started. We filed for federal grant, and we were successful in getting a $500,000 grant for the next 2 years to improve the schools in Homer with security and possible metal detectors if they want them. That's up to them. We're going to sit down and try to figure it all out. A lot of these schools don't even, a lot of them have those buttons where you got to get clicked in. A lot of them don't even have that. You can just walk right into school. So with this grant money in the next 2 years, we're going to be able to work with Homer schools. We're going to be able to train their, we don't want the teachers addressing a school active shooter. No, we teach them a whole different thing with them. It's called run, hide, and flight. That's what we teach. And we've done that across the whole county office building, we train from that. Other municipality buildings we've trained, schools we've trained. Our training division has trained hundreds and hundreds of school faculties, and no, we don't want them. We'll take care of the bad guy. We want them to take care of the children that are in the school and themselves, to get them in a safer spot so we can go in and face the bad guy. So that once we get that underway, which we're gonna start soon, because we just got awarded that grant. We're going to use it as a pilot program. The sheriff's office is going to reach out to other municipalities within the county and get them on board as well, so that we can do the same thing in other schools and hopefully keep. When they see a successful program, we have a better chance of getting another grant for another school. Yes, ma'am.
You may have touched on this already, and I apologize. But do you go into the schools that are within the district of Will County? Do you go in there and sit down with the teachers and the principal and all that and train them how to react if there's an active shooter on the premises?
Yes, we do. A lot of them reached out to us and asked us to come and train. Once they realized that our whole department was retrained on active shooters, they reached out to us to say, hey, could you come and train our faculty so that our faculty know what to do if this happens with our children. And we're at the point now where we're reaching out to schools as well and saying, look, let us come in and let us train you. It's like a two-day training class. We'll train the whole faculty, and we'll let them know what they should do, where they should go. Like I said, it's run, hide, flight. It's what we teach them, where to go, where to be safe until we get there. And that's what we've trained our guys now is this. Used to be, if you had a situation like that, you waited for the cavalry to show up before you actually entered that building. We're not teaching them that anymore. The minute you get there, you got to go in and you got to find the active shooter, and you have to, you're the police. It's unfortunate. It's a dangerous job. We all knew it when we took it. I knew it 30 years ago when I took it, but we teach them, you got to go in there and you got to confront the shooter and before everybody else gets there. So yes, we do. We go around all the schools that they ask us, and now we're starting to reach out to other schools to do the same thing.
So they would have to ask you?
No, they not anymore. We are identifying the schools we've not taught yet, and we're reaching out to them to say, hey, do you want us to come? Now, if they don't want us to come, we can't force ourselves in the door, and you know what I mean. And believe it or not, there has been a few schools that have not wanted us to come because they just, you know, a lot of schools hide stuff that's going on in their school because they don't want you to know about it. So, but yeah, some have said, no, we don't want you to come, but we highly encourage it. Anybody else?
How are the officers doing that were shot?
Well, the one took a grazed wound right across his forearm. Another inch, it would have blew his whole elbow off. The other one took one right here. Would have went through his ribs, and probably most likely we'd be dealing with a fatal, I believe. But luckily, he had his ballistic vest on, and he's got a big, big lump. But they're doing well. We have a social worker that works for us, and we do a critical incident debriefing where we sit down with these officers who were all there that night and saw these two guys take these two shots, and we offer them resources. Counseling so that, you know, so they can handle the stress. It's called a critical stress debriefing. It's because, you know, you may not wait, he went to bed that night, I'm sure it didn't even dawn on him, but now it's got to be like, oh my gosh, I was this close from not even being here. Yeah. So a lot of, you know, but they're good. They were good. We went to the hospital that night and so, yeah. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Is Sean here? Okay, Sean Walsh, the current Educational Regional Superintendent of Schools, is not here, and he's also running unopposed. We now move to the judicial candidates, and this is for the Circuit Court of the 12th Judicial Circuit, and our first is Ben Braun, the Republican candidate. Ben?
Wow, it does take a minute to get acclimated to the lights here. Good evening. Thank you for having me here. I'm Judge Ben Braun. I've had the privilege of serving as one of your associate judges here in Will County for the last 12 years, and I'd love to tell you about my family and my background and my education, but I think I need to spend a little bit of time telling you what it is that circuit court judges do and what three of us who presently have the position of associate judges do. You're actually going to be voting to fill two vacancies on the circuit court. They are separate offices, and these are the races that are at the absolute bottom of the ballot, right above the tax referenda, if there are any. I've had the privilege of serving as an associate judge for the last 12 years. In Will County, there are 37 judges, about two-thirds of whom are appointed. We're called associate circuit court judges, and then there are the elected judges, which are called circuit court judges. We call them full circuit court judges. There are 16 circuit court judges, 21 associate judges. So I was appointed by the circuit court judges 12 and a half years ago. What the circuit court judges do that associate judges don't do, it's not really as far as the authority that the judges have. The circuit court judges are the managers of the courthouse. First of all, one of the most important things they do is they make the appointments of the associate judges. And every 4 years they decide which of those judges essentially keep their jobs. Second of all, the circuit court judges are essentially the managers of the courthouse, so they tend to be the supervising judges of the individual divisions. The chief judge is always an elected circuit court judge. The head of the felony division, the presiding judge of the felony division is an elected circuit court judge. The head of the misdemeanor division is a circuit court judge, and the head of the civil division is a circuit court judge. So typically they are responsible for supervising the work of four or five, six other judges. And third, what most people don't recognize are the circuit court judges are responsible for administering a $25 million budget that's allocated by the county board to run your court system. So they're responsible for being good shepherds of your tax dollars. In this office, or for these races, unlike a lot of the other offices, we're actually rated by our peers, the other judges, the lawyers that appear before us. And I've handed out to some of you, I have on the table, and I kind of call it a report card. It's the bar poll ratings, and it's not the be-all and end-all of how you should vote, but it should give you an idea of what our peers think of us, the other judges and the lawyers that appear before us. And really, in 12 and a half years on the bench, my record is pretty much an open book because I've sat in just about every division of the courthouse. I've heard felony cases before. I've sat in misdemeanor courts for a number of years, sat on the divorce court for 3 years. And I practiced law for 20 years in this county before then. So for those of you that think the bar poll is important, it's there for you. The other thing I should tell you about is my experience. Because I've served in a number of divisions in the courthouse, a lot of time on a criminal call, I presided over more than 100 criminal jury trials. So that's experience that's important when people are coming before you to be appointed to these positions. Before I talk about what my vision is for the court system, I should tell you about what my judicial philosophy is, and that is every case is important. I would bet that most of the people here are not in the court system right now. But if it's your traffic ticket, if it's your daughter's divorce, if it's a grandchild that's been involved in some problems, or let's say if you've been involved in an automobile accident and been sued, or you're suing someone for injuries or a contract breach, that case is important, even though it's not hitting the newspapers. And because of that, it's important that we move your case through the system at an appropriate rate. We have some of the busiest courtrooms in the state here, and that's because, number one, our population growth, and number two, our transportation network. There are literally tens of thousands of people passing through the county every year that get caught up in the court system, and that's one of the reasons why a new courthouse is being built. So my judicial philosophy, being that every case is important, I have to tell you why I'm running. I'm really trying to improve the court system here, okay? After 12 and a half years on the bench in a number of divisions, and after 20 years practicing law in this county before then, I think I can help, number one, instill a culture of productivity and efficiency. Identifying in the individual divisions, what are cases that can be resolved more quickly? And that's an awful lot of cases that are not complicated from a legal perspective. And identifying those cases so that we can move them through the system a little bit quicker, a little bit more efficiently, and that has a number of effects. Number one, it reduces legal fees, which is really a major complaint by people that are caught up in the court system. Number two, it relieves litigants, witnesses, people that are involved in cases of the stress of coming to court. And after practicing law and representing people for 20 years, I know it's stressful to be caught up in litigation. At the very least, it's a distraction, and at the most, it's quite a burden. So I'm asking you for your vote on November 6th. My record is an open book. It speaks for itself. I've been endorsed by the Will County Sheriff's Department and the MAP Union, which represents the sergeants and administrators, and I'm tremendously honored by that endorsement because those folks are in the courthouse every day. They staff the courtrooms. It is the largest law enforcement entity in the county. I'm honored to have their endorsement. I'm also honored to have the endorsement of the Joliet Fraternal Order of Police. Again, those folks are in the courthouse every day. They see how courtrooms are run. And I'm also honored to have the endorsement of Will Grundy Building Trades and Central Trades. You're going to hear from a number of people that are up you have the benefit of having all four judicial candidates here tonight. They're all good people, okay? Three of them, including myself, are judges right now. We were cordial before we announced and started running. We're going to be cordial after these races. But we all have, I think, maybe a little different vision of what we think our courthouse should be. I'm honored to serve in your courthouse. It is your courthouse. I just have the privilege of sitting in one of your courtrooms. So I'm Ben Braun, and I'd be honored to have your vote on November 6th.
Questions for Judge Braun?
Thank you very much.
Our next speaker is the Democratic candidate for the 12th Judicial Circuit, and that's Judge David Garcia.
Boy, I didn't think the lights were that bright. Well, the first thing I gotta say is there's a library on Weber Road. I mean, didn't realize that. I've been a judge now 5 years, and all the five years I've been in the family court. Before that, I was an attorney here in Will County for 18 years. I did all kinds of cases. I did criminal, traffic, I did real estate. I put a lot of people in homes here in Will County. And you know, as you look at me, you're seeing what the American dream is really about. I was the first Latino judge ever appointed in Will County. I'm number one. I came from a poor side of Chicago, raised by my mother, who was, you know, as anybody that's my age will know that in those days, the way that our mothers used to punish us, they would be in prison right now. I just want to say, throw that out there. So, you know, I came out of a bad, very bad area and gang infested, and I was lucky enough to have a really, really strong mother, and I had, you know, friends, and we went and played baseball. And that's basically what kept me straight. I got married, and it's not because I had to, you know. I had kids 4 years after we were married. I've been married 42 years. I have two children, a girl and a boy. I have three grandchildren, and everybody here knows that when you have grandchildren, they're the best because, you know, at the end of the day, they go home. But I have a lot of experience. What I've, you know, the reason I'm running and have decided to run is because I've been in the family call for those 5 years, and in all the 5 years that I've been in that family call, we've never had a circuit judge. And this is a call that's very, very important, and I'm not putting down any other calls. I think all the other calls are important, and everybody should be treated with justice, which is our job. All the three judges here that you see before you believe that. I have no problem with Ben Braun. He's a good friend of mine. After this, we'll be friends. Before this, we were friends. The decision is yours. I think that there's some important things that have to be done at the family call. One example is, you know, my plan to improve counseling for the children, because if you remember from the last time I was here, that's one of my pet peeves. I think that in divorces, children are used too often, and they end up sometimes in the criminal justice system because of that. So I've talked to Jim Glasgow about using the counselors from the C Center. Right now they check out for any kind of sexual and that kind of stuff. But I want to use those counselors to give, you know, family reunification, for example. Or if the children need counseling, to get the counseling there. Because most of us can't afford it. You know, you guys know the problems with insurance, and a lot of times when it has to do with things like that, they're not going to cover. So I've been in talks with him about creating a system that's not funded by the county, so the taxpayers don't have to pay any money, that'll be on a scale so that underprivileged or low-income people can still get the counseling for their kids. And I don't care about the parents. I really don't. I mean, I care that they're going through a tough time, but I care more about the kids. And they need that counseling, and I think we could help them at that level. I've talked to the unions about, you know, if anybody here has been a union member, this is something that I've talked to the unions, and we're in the process of trying to get that instituted. And that is that, you know, their child support is based on a year's income, and yet some of them only work 9 months. So they end up paying their year's amount in 9 months, and when they're not working, they're still expected to pay that amount because it's averaged over 12 months. So I've talked to the unions about creating maybe a trust, and I've talked to my fellow judges about creating a trust where they put some money away so that when they're not working, their child support is paid for, they don't get arrested. You know, and I'm famous for arresting people for not paying their child support, as everybody knows. I'm trying to keep track of my time because the last time I was here, he pointed at me and went like this. Everybody else, he went like that. With me, he went. So I think the family call is really, really important. I'm currently the presiding judge in the family call. My fellow judge is out, and that was the presiding judge is out because she's, you know, personal reasons. So I was made the presiding judge there. But I think it's a shame that in our department, an associate like me or my fellow judge, or the one that just retired, were all associate judges and no circuit judges in our department. Because they're the ones that bring the teeth into that department and make change. And that's what I want to do. I want to do change. Now, I want to stay there. People think I'm crazy because every time I walk out the door, I got to look both sides because everybody's mad at me. You know, so that I'm not surprised that the polls, I was rated lower than my opponent. But you got to remember that those polls are just in people's opinion, and they don't separate it between judges and attorneys. It's just a straight poll. And if you look to the to the ISBA website, who conducts the poll, it says it right there. That this is not an endorsement. It's just another tool that you use. And as a fact, we're both recommended. So it doesn't say this one is more recommended than that one, because these attorneys like him more than, you know, I was happy to get 50% actually, because I'm in the divorce court. So I was really happy actually. So you know, I guess that's all I have. Does anybody have any questions? No? Okay. Wait a minute. I have a question. If I grab a Republican cake because I like the cake better, will it be held against me? No?
The cakes are identical. We don't want any chocoholics eating all the, you know, the wrong cake. So our last candidate speaking tonight is candidate for Congress. And you have two more. Oh, I'm sorry, the two more judges. I got to turn the ballot over. You know, got to flip the page here. I'm sorry. As Victoria McKay Kennison, candidate for the 12th Judicial Circuit. Hard to edit, these lights are a murder. Thank you.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Boy, you almost gave me a little bit of a heart attack there. My name is Victoria McKay Kennison, and thank you for inviting me to come tonight. It's a pleasure to be here with all of you to speak to you. I'm going to try and sidestep this light a little bit. I can tell you that it's been my honor to serve as one of your Will County Associate Judges this past 7 years. And I am running this year for circuit court position because it's important that Will County maintain a strong, experienced circuit court with judges who have a proven track record of resolving cases in a fair and efficient manner, treating everyone fairly and equally under the law. And that's what we're talking about, is you want judges that have that critical experience of having worked in these courts. I am someone who has worked in literally every law division in the courthouse. including our criminal misdemeanor felony courts, as well as family division. I served in the divorce court. I also served in our domestic violence court and orders of protection. These are all very vital courts. And it's someone that has also spent 15 years practicing law prior to becoming a judge. I feel that my experience as a whole makes me the most qualified candidate for this Second Circuit Court vacancy. And just so that we're clear, because I appreciate what happened when Ken introduced me, he mentioned he forgot to turn the ballot over. And that's critical. Please remember that this position that I am running for is literally the last elected position on your ballot. And in some places, it'll be on the front side of the ballot, and in others, it'll be on the back side. So please make sure to go all the way to the end. And if my mother were here, she would say, just start on the back side and then go forward. Okay? So just a little bit about myself personally. I've been a resident of Will County for 22 years. I live in Joliet with my husband. We've been married for almost 16 years now. Together, we have three adult children and four beautiful grandchildren. Unfortunately, they've got us divided. I've got two of them in Arizona and two here, so we just keep traveling back and forth. But it's been my great honor to be a mother and grandmother, as well as to have been able to spend the last 22 years dedicating myself to perfecting my profession and trying to every day improve our justice system. I've also been very involved in the community over the years. Here in Will County, I have served on numerous civic and local charity boards, including Will County CASA, which, for anyone who's not familiar with that program, that's the court special advocates for abused and neglected children, so what we commonly refer to as guardian ad litems. And I also served on the Boy Scouts board, and I'm the former president of the Will County Women's Bar Association, former president of Will County Legal Aid Program, now known as Prairie State Legal Services, a wonderful organization here in Will County that was providing services and continues today to serve all of our indigent citizens in the county, including our senior citizens, as well as victims of domestic violence and children, again, in school issues. So as your next circuit court judge, or one of your next two circuit court judges, what I am committed to is continuing the good works of our problem-solving courts. Is everybody familiar with problem-solving courts? Okay. Problem-solving courts are special courts that are designed to address target populations that suffer from mental health or substance abuse issues. And we are very fortunate here in Will County to have four such courts. And I don't have time to get into each of those four, but you're all familiar, I'm certain, with the terrible opioid crisis that we're dealing with, not just here in Will County, but across the state and really across the nation. And so what we have here in Will County is courts that address those issues. So Veterans Court is one of those courts. And we have almost 33,000 veterans that live here in Will County that have served abroad as well as domestically, and they return from their service and they are suffering from certain illnesses or injuries, such as post-traumatic stress, traumatic brain injuries, depression and anxiety, and other issues. And then they may develop a substance abuse issue. These combined may land them, or they find themselves, in our court system for a reason, one reason or another. And if they are eligible to come into our program, if they are nonviolent probation eligible, we take them into these courts. We get them full evaluations, and then we make sure that they receive all of the treatment that is required. And we're very fortunate because this is a collaborative type of approach, which means that we utilize the professionals in the community as well as we look to the Veterans Administration. We have a liaison from the VA that comes and participates in our team. And we have psychologists and other professionals, including the state's attorney, probation officers, defense attorneys, and of course the judge. And we work to make sure that we have perfected the treatment plan for these individuals. And at the end of the program, when they are successful and they graduate, and that's what it is, it's a graduation, they will have their charges either dismissed or, because of the nature of the charge and their history, they may have a conviction, but they have or will have avoided prison time. And that's really essential here. We're trying to find alternative methods to deal with certain individuals in our community that are not the individuals that should be in prison, but need the assistance that we can provide. And we've had great success with these programs. We've reduced the cost of incarceration. These problem-solving courts, from a practical and economical standpoint, for my CPAs that are here, they're about 1/6 the cost of the traditional courts. And most importantly, when we're talking about these individuals, they, at the end of the program, are healthy, they are employed most often, or back in school, further job training, and they are able to come back into the community as productive members of that community. And that's what we're talking about. That reduction in recidivism is also critical. We have a recidivism rate of about 15-20% from the problem-solving courts, and that's a huge difference from what you have in individuals who come off of parole and probation. And just to let you know, in 2016, the most recent state study that we have, the recidivism rate within 3 years for individuals that were previously in prison is 43%, and for probation it's 35%. So when I'm talking about 15-20% recidivism rates for individuals from our problem-solving courts, you can understand how important it is that we do these courts. And I'm getting that message as well. So again, thank you so much for having me. I'm happy to stay and answer any questions after the meeting is over. My name is Victoria Kennison, and I would greatly appreciate your support and your vote November 6th.
We have a question over here.
This is not a personal question for you, Victoria. I could have asked any one of the candidates, but and perhaps this is an uninformed question, but I'm interested in the relationship between the court system in Will County and ICE.
The relationship between the court system and ICE. I appreciate that. I think that might be a better question for the sheriff, though, because as far as the court's relationship with ICE, we don't have an ongoing communication with ICE. We just have to follow the law. So I appreciate that. Maybe Sheriff Kelly might be able to address that for you. But I should just mention as well that I am very fortunate to be endorsed also by the Will County Sheriff's Department and our supervisors. I was just looking at Sheriff Kelly, so I just want to make sure that I acknowledge how important it is. I think that I have the endorsements of law enforcement, that's critical, as well as Joliet FOP and Bolingbrook Police. And of course, the mayor, Mayor Noak, was here earlier. I was greatly honored to receive his endorsement as well. Any other questions? Thank you again.
Add me on the other side of the ballot, the other candidate here. Sure, you want, she's got a mic right back here, Mike. Unless, do you want to come up here and do it, Cam? Why don't you do it up here, this way you'll be on camera and on the mic here.
So what was the question again, the relationship that we have with ICE? In what regards, ma'am, are you referring to?
Well, I've heard rumors that ICE is rounding up numerous people in the county, and I just wanted to know what's going on.
Well, I can tell you that if ICE is rounding up, I'm assuming you mean here people here illegally, that they have not contacted us for any type of assistance wanting us to help them do that. We've not gotten a call from ICE saying, you know, we're doing this, can you throw us a couple guys to help out? We have not gotten that call. So if they're doing it, they're doing it on their own.
Are you unaware?
To my knowledge, I don't know if ICE is in Will County. They've not, like I said, they've not reached, usually when other, whether they're federal, state departments, you know, law enforcement departments come to our county, they'll reach out to us and say, hey, we're going to be in your area, in this specific area, looking for, so they give us a heads up so we know that they're there. We have not received any information from them saying, we're in Will County and this is where we're going to be.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Does ICE have to notify you, though, if they were to come? Because sometimes they run states. So it is correct
Right. They do not have to notify us, but it's common practice. If Will County Sheriff's Office goes into another county, it's good playing rules to let that municipality and or other county know you're in their yard looking for something.
But you're at a county level. ICE is a county. They have the authority.
Do you live in Grand Haven?
I'm sorry.
Do you live in Grand Haven?
I'm sorry. I thought it was an open-ask question form. I was just asking. If I come in here, I'm sorry.
Right.
And our next speaker is the Democratic candidate for the 12th Judicial Circuit, Vincent Cornelius.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Vincent Cornelius, and I'm a candidate for Circuit Judge of the 12th Judicial Circuit. I live just a little bit north of here in Naperville with my wife, Zena, of 27 years. And my daughter, who attended Ohio State and works downtown Chicago. I have a 20-year-old son who is a student at the University of Illinois. I grew up in Joliet, where I was raised by a beloved teacher in the community of 34 years, and I attended Joliet Catholic High School. I am proud to say that I am last year I received the Outstanding Alum Award, the Career Achievement Award from Joliet Catholic High School. I went on to play basketball for Coach Pat Sullivan at the University of St. Francis, where I was an academic All-America player. I have served as vice chairman of the board of the University of St. Francis. After that, I went to Northern Illinois University College of Law, where I currently serve as vice chairman of the board. This is my 28th year in the practice of law. I am the only lawyer in Illinois history to serve as president of the Illinois State Bar Association, as Chancellor of the Academy of Illinois Lawyers, and as President of the Illinois State Bar Association, as President of the Illinois Bar Foundation. I am also the first and only lawyer from Will County to serve as President of the State Bar Association, and I was the first African American elected to that 32,000 member, as President of that 32,000 member association. I have tried jury trials and bench trials all over this region. I am proud to say that my firm has not lost a jury trial since 1997, and I'm still angry about that one. But I will tell you that it has been a joy for me in the courtroom to try cases. You've heard much about the common sense courts in Will County, and as president of the Illinois State Bar Association, I fought hard for the development of common sense courts as well as the funding for those courts in Springfield. In addition to that, my firm, the last lawyer that I hired, Christine Haniotis, was instrumental in the development of each and every one of those courts in Will County, and it's one of the areas that my law firm focuses in. It has been an experience for me as a trial lawyer to try every kind of case. I've tried every kind of case from the homicide case to the million-dollar injury case, and we have won those kinds of cases. I am recognized by best lawyers in America. I am recognized by leading lawyers. I am recognized by super lawyers. I'm recognized by those organizations because of the success that we have in the courtroom, because of our excellence in presentation in the courtroom. I would also like to say that when it comes election time, when you go into the ballot booth and you look at this ballot, ordinarily you will see that judges are at the bottom of the ballot or at the end of the ballot, or in this case, on the back of the ballot. You don't recognize the names. You don't know who they are. You guess. You guess by someone who has a last name like yours. You guess because someone is of your gender. You guess. And so I am thankful for the opportunity to have an opportunity to speak to you tonight so that you can get a sense of who all of us are. And I thank you for coming out to give us this opportunity to talk to you. And so, that you don't have to guess. The Illinois State Bar Association undertakes a poll. They take a poll of the judges and the lawyers in Will County. And in that poll, they ask the judges and the lawyers in Will County about the lawyers and judges. And they ask them about issues such as integrity, impartiality, whether or not they meet the requirements of the law. They ask you about legal knowledge. They ask us all of those questions. And the Will County lawyers and judges rated me higher in my race in 7 of 8 of those categories. So I am the only one of the judges, of the judicial candidates tonight, who has not served as a judge. Well, I think there are at least 5 circuit judges in Will County right now who did not serve as circuit judges before, as associate judges before they became circuit judges. And so I've shared a lot of information with you about my leadership. I have also served on governor's commissions, on legislative committees. I've served on Supreme Court commissions. In fact, I currently serve on 2 Supreme Court commissions. So all the places where you've heard that I've served, you can see that I am the one who is not squinting and complaining because I have been accustomed to the bright lights. I am accustomed to the pressure of the courtroom. I am accustomed to being a leader. I am accustomed to being engaged in the community. I am accustomed to all the things that it requires to be an excellent judge. And I tell you that I believe that I am bent towards fairness. And I say all the time that the courthouse, when you get to the courthouse steps should always lead to a judge who is fair and who is just, and should always lead to a judge who hears people out, who listens to them. I will be that kind of judge. And so I thank you for the opportunity to speak to you this evening. And I would like to say also that I am endorsed by the operating engineers, Local 150. I'm endorsed by the Local 504, the American Federation of Teachers, where my mom was a member for over 25 years. And so that one means everything to me. I'm even endorsed by Our Revolution, the Bernie Sanders wing of the Democratic Party. And I'm the only one of 2 judges in the nation to receive their endorsement. And I ask for your endorsement at the ballot box on November 6th. Thank you very much.
And our final speaker tonight is the Republican candidate for U.S. Congress, Nick Stella. Nick?
Can you all hear me? You know, I've never been accused of being soft-spoken, so I'm going to forego the microphone. If you can't hear me, let me know. I'll either speak louder or I'll be happy to use the microphone. My name is Nick Stella. I'm not a politician. I want to give you guys a little bit of background of who I am. Local boy, born on right outside of the city. My folks moved out to the Derry and Downers Grove area in the late 70s. If you know anything about Derry, that almost makes me a native of there. I grew up there, graduated from Downers Grove South High School. From Downers Grove South, I ended up going to Illinois Benedictine College, graduated from there. And then from there, I went to Loyola University Stritch School of Medicine in Maywood. I spent the next more than a decade of my life in Maywood. Went to medical school there, did a residency in internal medicine, and did a fellowship in cardiology. Yep, I'm a doctor, cardiologist. I actually see some people I know here today. That's a good thing. So the next logical question may be, well, what the hell are you doing running for office? Right? I'm certifiable, that's it, ladies and gentlemen. No, I'm running for office because, like a lot of us in the country, I got sick and tired of where our country was going. And if you don't like where your country's going, who do you have to blame?
Yourselves.
Well, I don't know. If I blame ourselves, I would, well, to a certain extent, I would agree with you. But I blame our politicians, because they're the ones who bring us where we are, right? Yes, you could blame yourselves for voting for some of the politicians. Right. That's for sure. No doubt about that. So I thought long and hard, what am I going to do about this? After a lot of introspection and a lot of consideration, I decided, you know what? I want to be a part of a solution. so I'm going to run for office. Why? Because I think that the residents of the 11th District deserve a representative who knows what the word representative means. How many people here feel that our congressmen are doing a good job representing us and our congresswomen? I don't think many of us would say that they're really thrilled with Congress, right? Yeah, I think we've sent people to Washington, D.C. who've become more enamored with their party or with themselves than for the reason they're supposed to be there. Because you're supposed to be there to represent the people that sent you there. That's why you're there. Because ladies and gentlemen, before you're a Republican and before you're a Democrat, you're an American. And they've forgotten this. So it's about time that we take our Congress back. It's about time we take our government back. I'm not a politician. I've never held public office. I ran for office once 2 years ago, in this very same position, and I came this close to winning in the primary. I wasn't supposed to win. Everyone told me, who the hell are you? You're a doctor, go take care of people. Leave this politician stuff up to us politicians. Well, I came this close to winning in the primary because I got out and I met people and I talked to people. And I heard what people wanted and people heard what I stand for. Those people came to the polls and they voted for me. A person who wasn't supposed to get hardly any votes nearly won the primary 2 years ago. So that's why I'm back. And I did win my primary, and now it's off to the general election. I think that you people sitting here, and all the other people of the 11th Congressional District, deserve a representative who will listen to you. Deserve a representative who will go to Congress every day to fight for the people of the 11th Congressional District. Now, I'm not gonna stand up here and I'm not gonna belittle or I'm not gonna impugn the name of our current congressman. But what I can tell you is when you send me to Washington, D.C., I'm going to represent all the Republicans. But I'm also going to represent all the Democrats in the district, and I'm also going to represent all the independents in the district, and I'm also going to represent all the people who just don't care to choose. Because it's your job when you go to Congress. Your job in Congress is to represent everyone in the district, not just the people who voted for you, not just the people who are in your individual political party. We need representatives across the country who will really remember what that word means. So when I go to Washington, I'm going to represent you. There are many things that this county needs, that this district needs. We're sitting in Will County. This district is composed of Will, a little bit of Cook, a bunch of DuPage, some Kane and some Kendall. Majority of Will County though, and DuPage County. We need spending on infrastructure. We need to get an expansion of I-80. We need to get an expansion of I-88. We need to bring jobs back to this district. We've had tax cuts which have brought a lot more wealth into people's pockets, working class, and we've seen an expansion of jobs in this economy. But this district isn't seeing that. And that's because this district does not have an advocate for this district. This district does not have someone who goes to Washington and fights for this district. I can tell you as a physician, 60 to an 80 hour work week is my normal. I'm used to that. You know, we even do some weeks even longer than that. I don't think there's any congressman out there that can say that. And what I can promise you, I don't make promises because I'm not a politician, but I'll make you with this one promise. When you send me to Washington, I will work harder than any congressman you've seen because that is my duty when you send me there. My duty is to work on behalf of the people of the district. And I would ask all of you for your votes, and I would ask you then to grade me and see how well I work on your behalf. And if you don't think I've worked hard enough, then vote me out next term. Because that's what you're supposed to do. So we have to blame ourselves, right, sir? And if a congressman isn't doing his job, who do we have to blame for leaving him in office? Ourselves, right? That also goes for state representatives, and that goes for all kinds of other incumbents that we just vote into office. I won't even get into the state politics in Illinois because Springfield is a morass. We all know that. but I come here just to let you know who I am and what I stand for. I'm not standing here to tell you a bunch of lies. I'm not gonna make you a bunch of promises other than I'm going to work on your behalf. I'm going to do what congressmen are supposed to do. I'm going to represent each and every one of you. And even if you don't vote for me, guess what? If I win, I'm gonna still represent you because that's what you're supposed to do. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Nick Stone. Yes, ma'am.
Some questions. Can we get a mic?
As a physician, I'd like to know how you would fix some of the problems that we have in our healthcare system.
Oh, it's a great question.
Considering we have a lot of seniors here, the cost of pharmaceuticals are atrocious. Our medical costs go up all the time. Our insurance premiums go up. So I'd like to know, I think many people have tried to fix the system. So what would your solution be, seeing that you are a physician?
Well, first of all, we can talk about this for about the next 6 hours, but I don't think you guys will want me talking up here for 6 hours. I'll give you a few of my ideas. First of all, prescription drugs, very important. Why do we pay so much for our prescription drugs? How come you can get them cheaper from Canada or from Europe? Why? It's because the middlemen, PBMs. How many of you are familiar with OptumRx, Express Scripts? A bunch of guys can probably get your meds from them, right? Those are called PBMs, pharmacy benefits managers. All those middlemen, like Express Scripts and OptumRx, take a cut. So a manufacturer makes a pill, a patient takes a pill. There are so many different layers in between, and all those layers are adding to the cost of those pills. Those layers aren't present in other countries. And that's why, one of the major reasons why our pharmaceuticals cost so much more than they are in other countries. So what we need to do is we need to get rid of some of those middlemen. PBMs came into being because the thought was they were going to decrease the cost of medications. They're going to buy for a whole bunch of people at once, that buying in bulk was going to cut down the price. And initially, the healthcare economists said, these are a good idea. Now, healthcare economists are saying, this has turned 180 degrees. These companies that were supposed to be decreasing the cost of medications are actually increasing the cost of medications. Why? Because they found out they can make a profit. So one of the things we need to do is we need to get rid of a lot of those middlemen to bring down the cost. Now, any company that makes drugs should be allowed to make a profit off them. That's what this country's about, right? However, there's always that greed margin. I think we were all familiar with the one CEO of a drug company who bought a certain drug that no one else made and then jacked up the price 1,000 times.
Martin Shkreli.
Yes. There you go. I believe he's going to prison, and he should spend a long time in prison, right? So there's that problem, okay? We need to get rid of these middlemen and these bad actors who are doing these things. That'll help bring the cost down of pharmaceuticals, okay? Now, when you talk about healthcare in general, there are so many different aspects of it that raise the cost of healthcare. At the risk of standing up here in front of a bunch of judges and lawyers who will probably throw stones at me. Medical liability is a huge driver of the cost of medicine. Our previous administration said that's not the case. There's no reason that we need tort reform in this country. You go ask your doctor next time you see him and ask him how many tests he orders to CYA. You know what that stands for?
Yes.
Cover your ass, okay? There's a lot of tests that doctors order because they need to cover their rear ends. You go to any emergency room, tell that emergency room doctor you have a bad headache, and you're gonna automatically get a CT scan of your head, I guarantee it. Maybe one out of 10,000 people really needs that CT scan and may have a bleed in their brain. But the other 9,999 are going to get that CT scan as well because of the liability cost if that one out of 10,000 has a bleed in their brain. So we need national tort reform. You can leave that out there just at that. What else do we need? We need to stop protecting the insurance companies. Blue Cross Blue Shield used to be a non-for-profit organization. Did you know that?
Yes.
How many of you know how much profit Blue Cross Blue Shield Illinois has been making the last few years since they're no longer a non-profit? Over $1 billion a year. Over $1 billion a year. It's not very popular for politicians to say we want to go against insurance companies because the insurance lobby is one of the largest in the country, okay? But the problem is we've protected these insurance companies. One of the things we need is we need reciprocity agreements between the different states. We live here in Illinois. If you have a job here from a company in Illinois, why can't you buy your insurance from a company from Nebraska? Anyone know why? Because each state has their own insurance board that regulates the insurance that's sold in that state. So although a company in Nebraska may be certified by the Nebraska Insurance Board, they're not certified by Illinois, so you can't buy that policy, even though it's the best policy and the cheapest policy for you. We need to have reciprocity agreements between the states. On a national level, we need to do something like this. That will allow a true free market system so that if the best policy for you and your family comes from Wyoming, well, you can buy that policy. That'll promote competition. What does competition do to cost? We all know this. It drives down costs. That's one of the many things that we can do to help drive down the cost of healthcare. There's a lot of other things that we need to address. The cost that's involved in the administration of healthcare. How much of each healthcare dollar goes to the hospitals and the physicians? It's about 17 cents. All the rest of it's going to administration and other things. So I can talk for hours up here. I don't think you guys want to hear me talk for hours about up here. Is there any other questions that you have? Yes, ma'am.
Yes, our president has been quoted recently as being a little ambivalent about climate change. I know which side Bill Foster is on. President said there are scientists on both sides of the argument. I'd like to know which side you're on.
Well, you gotta, first of all, have you ever been to Columbia National Ice Fields in Canada?
Yes.
Any of you been there? They're outside of Banff, and this gentleman says he's been there. So if you've been there, they have a really great little display there, and it shows pictures of the glaciers going back to about the 1850s, I think, the first time they had cameras, and every so often. And the glaciers there have retreated, I think it's been about a mile and a half. Yeah, the climate's changing, there's no doubt about it. I mean, you can't deny that. The question becomes, why is the climate changing? And that's where I think you see a lot of debate. There are some people who are convinced that it is all our fault. There are some people who say, well, it might be our fault. And there's a few people who say, yeah, we have nothing to do with it. I think that we probably play a role in climate change, but this earth is an awfully big place, and the climate has been changing for millions of years. We had ice ages. You disagree? Okay, everyone's entitled to disagree. We've had ice ages. We've had periods where there's been lots of heat. Is this just one of those cycles? To be honest with you, I'm not a climate scientist. I don't have a strong opinion on that. What I do believe in is that we all are entitled to have clean air and clean water and unpolluted lands. I totally agree with that. That's something that we should always endeavor and strive to make sure that we have clean lands, clean air, and clean water. Anyone else have any questions? Thank you all very much. I appreciate your time. Sorry to keep you here late.
Thanks, everybody. A couple little closing announcements. First of all, somebody want to take a look? Jerry, who won the cake poll?
Too close to call.
Too close to call. No? like a lot of things these days. Early voting is going to start Monday at the Romeoville Village Hall. Early voting is going to start Monday, so you can vote Monday at the Romeoville Village Hall. Also, if anyone needs a ride to the polls, there are several folks who have volunteered to serve as chauffeurs. So if you know of anyone who can't get out and needs a ride to the polls, you can talk to Denise at the lodge. She has the names of the folks. A couple of them are here tonight. I'm one of them that's volunteered to drive folks if they need them. Any other announcements for the good of the order? Hearing none, enjoy some cake and coffee and mingle with our candidates. And again, thank you everyone for coming.